Chief, it's a pleasure to be able to interview you today. I'm David Walker. I'm a professor at Drake Law School and former dean of the school. And on behalf of the Southern District Historical Society, I have the opportunity to interview former Chief Justice of the Iowa Supreme Court, Lou Lavorato. And without further ado, Chief, let me, on behalf of all members of the bar and the society, thank you for joining us. And I'd like to begin with some comments from you about personal history, identity, and family roots.
Okay.
Shape an approach to everything that we do. And I know that your family's story is quite an interesting and compelling one with lessons even for today. Could you tell us about it?
Sure. I'm going to talk about Mom and Dad. My mother came over here from Italy when she was 6 months old. She was born in 1911. My dad came over here when he was 19. That would have been in 1920. And when he was 19 years old at the time, they both settled here in Des Moines, Iowa, South Side, which is at the time a thriving Italian community. He was a cobbler. He was trained as a cobbler. In other words, he actually made shoes in Italy. He had a choice, either to work in a chosen trade or to work in the fields, and he chose to learn a trade. So he really knew how to make shoes when he got here. In fact, made our baby shoes during the time that he was working. He started his shop on the south side. If anybody's familiar with Graziano grocery store, his shop was just to the west of Graziano.
Did he ever tell you why he came to America? He came alone,
yeah,
did he?
Well, Mussolini was coming to power, and he didn't want to be any part of that regime, and he just thought it would be better, and he got letters from friends that were over here in America, and they told him about the good life over here, and he wanted to get away from the turmoil over there in Italy, and that's why he came to this country. It's interesting, when he got here, of course, he couldn't speak a word of English, and they didn't understand him. And like most immigrants, they just gave him whatever name came to their mind. His real name is Gaetano, which is Guy in English, Gaetano in Italian, and they just pinned the name Charlie on his suit coat, and that stuck. Charlie stuck. But he would always sign his name Gaetano on his checks and things like that. But he did start a shoe shop on the south side of Des Moines, and then eventually moved to the downtown area, 14th and Grand, which is now a little park area. Mm-hmm. He married my mom in 1928, as I remember.
Does your mother also emigrate?
Yeah.
to the United States?
She went to school here in the United States because she came here in 6 months, which became an important issue here during World War II, and I'll explain that. In any event, I was a Depression baby, born in 1934. Things were tough. We lived with our grandparents, my grandparents, and my mom's side of the family all through the war. I attended St. Anthony School, a Catholic school. I can remember lining up and going to church every day and going to confession every Friday.
And you get a good education.
Get a good education. The nuns taught me, and I respected those nuns so much. And if it wasn't for them, I don't know where I'd be today. But I don't belong to that parish anymore. I'm outside of that parish, but I still tied to that parish, and because I just feel that loyalty. In 2006, there was a charter alumni hall of fame at St. Anthony School, and I was a charter member. They got my mugshot on the wall there in the school building, so I'm kind of proud of that.
How did you come to Drake University?
Well, I graduated from, I'll just progress and I'll get to that. I graduated from St. Anthony, went on to Dowling High School, and I wanted to go to college, and I knew Drake was going to be my school. didn't have the money. My parents said that they would finance my education if they had to mortgage their house. And I said, no, I ain't going to do that. I'm going to do it on my own. So I went into the Army hoping, and I knew if I served out my time, I'd get the GI Bill, which I did. Mm-hmm. And got out of the service 3 months early on a special program to attend college. And then ended up at Drake and graduated in 59 with a BSBA degree.
Now, your brother had gone to Drake, or did your dad work for the university?
Well, what happened was, after I had graduated and then graduated from law school, my brother wanted to go to law school. And, of course, my sister wanted to go to Drake. And so my dad was working in the daytime in the shoe shop and working at night as a janitor, actually, and to finance their education, to get them through Drake. And, you know, Drake had a program at this time. I think they still have it.
They do.
Which, you know, they give a lot of credit to employees of family members to attend Drake. And that's how these kids got through school, my brother and my sister. He went through undergraduate school, went into law school, and got a law degree. My sister got her degree.
Education would have meant a lot to your mom and dad. I think you told me that your father could quote Dante or love Dante.
Yeah, some of the professors were shocked when he was doing his janitor job. He would quote Dante, and he loved the opera, and he loved those Italian works. And he could, you know, his English was really broken, but he was bright. He was a bright guy. He taught himself how to read the newspapers. And very political. This guy was what we call today a yellow dog Democrat. but he loved his country. Whenever he had a little bit too much wine, he'd sing God Bless America.
Really?
Yeah.
Really? What do you remember about law school? The dean at the time would have been an immigrant or his family, himself, Martin Tollefson.
And he still had the accent. I can remember I finished out Drake undergraduate school, didn't have any money left, and I wanted to go to law school, so I went to him. I said, Dean, I just don't have any money. He said, don't you worry. We will take care of that. So they did. I got a scholarship, a Fisher scholarship. I think tuition back then, correct me if I'm wrong, was like about $235 a semester.
It's actually $125.
What, was it $125 a semester? Yeah, okay.
Somewhat more expensive today.
and I got a Fisher scholarship, which really helped. I worked all the way through school. I remember my senior year, I worked for a lawyer in Des Moines, and I learned how to read abstracts in Gary in Chin's class, right?
Yes.
Taught property, mm-hmm. and taught us how to read an abstract, and this lawyer put me on to abstracts. I was reading abstracts for him. He was out charging my time out at $20 an hour, and I was getting $1.25.
Well, you opened practice with a classmate after you graduated here in Des Moines.
I graduated first in the class, so I had an opportunity to work for a lot of firms. And I just said, you know, I think I'm just going to hang my shingle out, and I don't want to work for anybody. And I did. This classmate and I went into practice together. I think the first year we made like $5,000, split that. But it got better after that. We merged our firm with Williams and Hart, which was a small firm at the time. I was still a partner, and then I later became Williams, Hart, Lavorato, and Curry. So in effect, I never ever worked for anybody. I was on my own, you know.
Your record at Drake actually is quite a distinguished one. The Fisher Scholarship was a merit award, and you graduated in the top 10%, number one, obviously, Order of the Coif, and I know many of your classmates from that era remember and speak well of you. Have you maintained those friendships?
Oh yeah, well, of course. We were inducted into the 50-year club at the Iowa Bar Association here this spring, mm-hmm. and I met up with a lot of the fellows that I went to school with. We only had two women in that class. We started out with 75 students, and you know, back then anybody could get into law school. Not very many even got out.
Yes.
We graduated, I think it was 19, uh-huh. and two of them were women. Rosemary Sackett was just behind me, as I remember. And
She was.
At the law school. I also, as far as undergraduate school, I did pretty well undergraduate school. I graduated with honors. I was admitted to the Beta Gamma Sigma, which in business is a counterpart to Phi Beta Kappa and liberal arts. And
you were an accounting major, were you?
Accounting major, yeah. And then I was in the Freshman Honorary Society of Phi Beta Sigma, which is the Freshman Honorary Society. So I did pretty good in undergraduate school.
The accounting background probably came in helpful when you were working on budgets for the course.
So they asked me if I wanted to be an accountant. I said, nope, I don't want to be an accountant. I want to be a lawyer.
Your dad had wanted one of his sons to be a lawyer.
He always wanted one of his sons to be a lawyer, and that ended up, you know, two sons that became lawyers. Four grandchildren became lawyers. So he started a dynasty.
I noticed that you became quite proficient in real estate transactions, property law, abstracts. Your practice gravitated towards the courtroom, didn't it?
Courtroom, yeah. I always wanted to be a trial lawyer. And so I took everything that came through the door, I took it with the idea that hopefully I'd get enough business I could concentrate on just litigation. And that's what happened. I became a trial lawyer.
Were there people who influenced you in that direction? You said you always wanted to be a trial lawyer. There are different areas of practice, of course, and the courtroom is itself a specialty.
You know, in those days, I didn't have any mentors except judges. And I used to go down, and you know, if I had a problem or anything, I'd go down and talk to the judges, but they'd give me some good advice. I'd try cases, and they critique my performances in these trials after the trials. So those people were my mentors, and they encouraged me to be a trial lawyer. One of my biggest mentors was former Chief Justice C. Edwin Moore. I called him my mentor. Anytime I had a problem, I could call him.
Uh-huh.
I was honored to be a pallbearer at his funeral. That's how close I was to him. I'll give you a story about old Chief. When he retired, he came down. I was chief at the time, chief in Polk County, the 5th Judicial District. He came down to work. I gave him all that he wanted to handle the post-conviction relief actions, and I gave him all those cases, and he did a beautiful job. I can remember one time when the Court of Appeals reversed one of his cases. And he was so angry. I said, well, Chief, don't give up yet. You know, there could be an application for further review to the Supreme Court. Take care of it. My God, that's what happened. There was an application for further review in the Supreme Court. They took it and affirmed his decision.
Is that right?
He was quite a guy.
He too was a graduate of the law school,
right.
and he taught trial court. Do you happen to have his course?
Yeah. I think that's probably the time that I really wanted to become a trial lawyer.
He was a trial court judge,
yeah,
municipal
trial
judge.
Court judge
and
he was something else. Whenever I would go up to the Supreme Court to argue, he just teased the dickens out of me in all arguments. And that's how close I was with him.
He was wonderful.
He was a wonderful guy.
Quite an extraordinary chief, too. The orientation of your practice was primarily towards the plaintiff side.
Plaintiff side, yeah. I always boasted that I never represented an insurance company. I always represented injured plaintiffs.
You had an identification with individuals, a personal identification. Is there a philosophy, a passion, just a bias for representing people who are injured?
Just like a lot of most Americans, you know, they like to be for the person, the underdog, and that was my position. I wanted to. And from the area that I came from, heck, I was a poor kid myself, and I could see help that anything I did to help those people would be great as far as I was concerned. I wanted to do the best I could for them, of course. And these are the folks that I wanted to represent because I could identify with them.
I was on the faculty at Drake in the later 70s, and I know that your firm was quite prominent and Lavorato, quite a successful and renowned trial attorney, and yet there came a time when you applied for a vacancy on the Iowa District Court. That can you talk about that?
Yeah, I can remember telling my partners right back in the middle 60s, early, late 60s, I told them, I said, look, I've always wanted to be a judge, and someday I'm going to put my name in to become a judge. Mm-hmm. And they just poo-pooed it, and I said, okay, the time comes, I'm putting my name in. And I did, I put my name in 79, become a district court judge. And Governor Bob Bray appointed me to the district court bench in 79. So fulfilled that dream.
Was that a difficult transition, going from the area, the arena in front of the bench to the work behind the bench?
No, I loved it. I really loved that kind of work. In fact, the first case they gave me was a wrongful death action right out of the box. So I was pretty much at home with the cases, and it came easy, and I loved it. I loved being around lawyers and people. Great experience.
Were your mother and father present at your swearing in?
Yeah, they had pictures in the newspaper. My dad hugging me, my mom. It was quite an experience.
The work of the trial courts has changed. The pace become more demanding. The necessity of management and judicial management of limited resources, very real and continuing. Can you tell us about some of your work as a district court judge and then eventually the chief judge of the Fifth
Sure.
Judicial District?
I can remember going into equity. I won't mention the judge's name, but he was scheduled. We were all on a schedule. Everybody rotated. And rotated for one, we're in a position for 1 year. And I can remember this older judge, I was just a rookie, and he said to me, he said, you got a lot of steam in you. And he said, I'm getting to be old. He says, why don't you go up and take care of equity for me? And I said, okay, judge, I'll do that. I liked the guy too, I liked the judge, and because it was a strenuous position being an equity judge at that time. We handled all the 70A cases. All the equity cases that came through there. As I remember, I must have written probably 150 opinions in that court in that period of time. Mm. And that's when we were just starting with 70A cases.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that was quite an experience. I remember I was assigned to family court, and when I got into family court, it was a mess. These so many continuances, the docket was just backed up, and I said, hey, I got to do something here to clean this mess up. So I started a settlement conference procedure, which today it's comparable to mediation, actually. And what I told lawyers, I had one basic rule. You don't get to trial unless you come through me. And at first, the lawyers kind of resisted it, but after a while, they really, really accepted it, thought it was a good idea. Here's what I did. I sat at the counsel table with the clients and the lawyers, and tried to settle the case. If we could settle it, what I'd do is get it right up on the bench, incorporate the agreement in the record, and grant them the divorce. And if we could settle it, we'd at least whittle down all the issues, whittle the issues down to a good workable area for the trial judge. The judge was supposed to hear the case.
Was that primarily in the family law area, or did you extend the settlement conferences and mediations to civil suits generally?
When I became administrative criminal judge, that's all we did in that court was to take pleas, handle motions, sign fee orders, that kind of thing. I said, hey, I got some downtime here. What I'll do is start initiate a settlement conference in the civil cases. And we did that. Was pretty successful. I really enjoyed that. Then when I became chief in 83, that was 4 years later, I initiated a small claims mediation program where we'd use a retired businessman to come in. We wouldn't pay him. We just, they loved it. These folks loved it to do that. And it's really in existence today, but a much, much better program under Joe Harrison. In fact, I think it's become a prototype for a lot of the counties in the state.
Mm-hmm.
One other thing I did is we were having backup problems in juvenile court. And I went to the court, Supreme Court, and I said, you know, I'd really like some money to hire some referees in juvenile court. And they said, well, we don't have any money to give you. And I said, well, what if I hire some volunteers to do that? Go at it. So I did. I hired, I think my first volunteer was Dick Leifert. And Dick was in that program for 13 years. And so that was another thing that we did.
Was Larry Eisenhower a juvenile court referee?
Yeah. Yep.
Of course, Chief Judge of the Court of Appeals
Chief Judge of the Court of Appeals, yeah.
Can you tell us about the decision to become the Chief Judge of the 5th Judicial District? Was there... you had only been on the court for 4 years.
Before that time, I'd set up this program for settlement conferences in family law, and they knew I was interested. Judges knew I was interested in administration, and I showed the potential, and they didn't. I think I was the only one that put my name in for chief. So far, nobody else wanted the job.
There came a time not too many years later when you determined that you'd like to be on the Iowa Supreme Court.
That was always my goal, even after becoming a judge. I said I wanted to be on the Iowa Supreme Court, and that was my ultimate goal, to be on the Iowa Supreme Court. I always wanted to do that. I was going in with that intention when I became a district judge.
Why was that a personal goal?
Well, you know, what do they say? A students become judges, and B students, I don't know what B students do. C students, they'll make the money, as I understand it. So, you know, I guess it's just a natural thing. I love to do research, write.
Uh-huh.
So that was a calling.
So... Give me a broad perspective, if you would. You are nominated and appointed to the court, again, with fanfare and acclaim. I know your father and mother were there.
And they were.
And the Register, you know, covered it. And it is a wonderful story.
The interesting part of it is my political persuasion was different from Governor Branstad, and my friends in the Democratic Party told me, you'll never, ever get that position. And I said, I don't know about that. And it's a tribute to Branstad, because that's one of his legacies. He did appoint judges on basis of merit. He didn't particularly look at political affiliation. And nor did Governor Ray, for that matter. So. The judicial branch is really fortunate in that respect.
That's an important tradition in Iowa, to divorce politics from the merit selection process, isn't it?
One of my colleagues, Justice Uhlenhop, who didn't live too long after I got appointed to Supreme Court, he spearheaded the effort to remove judges from politics in 1962, and really was a driving force behind our constitutional amendment to take judges out of politics.
That would have been just about the time you were in law school,
right,
when all that activity was taking place, wasn't it?
Right.
Maybe we can return to that. The Court of Appeals is created in 1976,
right,
and you are appointed to the Iowa Supreme Court in 1986, will not become Chief Judge until 2001.
I became Chief Justice in
Justice.
November 2000.
November 2000.
That's when Chief McGivern retired.
Can you give us an aerial view of the work of the Supreme Court and how you saw it change from the time you were arguing cases before Chief Justice Moore to your appointment in 86 to your culminating State of the Judiciary address, just an overview, and then maybe we can get into some specific opinions.
Well, when I went on the court, we were in divisions. We were assigned, I remember going to the Supreme Court building, or not Supreme Court building, going to the Capitol building, and I had a friend, and we had a flatbed, moved all my material into my office on a Sunday. The following Monday, I went up to see Chief Justice Ward Reynoldson. He said, here are your cases. Go to work. They assigned me three cases. I also signed a couple of procurement opinions. These are the no-brainers, the ones that can be decided by established law. That's how I got started. And looking back now, having reviewed the number of decisions or opinions that I wrote, I think over that 20-year period, I wrote like 546 published opinions.
Majority opinions.
Yeah.
That doesn't include the dissenting.
No, I didn't even take time to read check those out. But in addition, I did the per curiams, the no-brainers. I know that I had to write over 600 opinions in that period of time, because we did. Early on, we did those opinions as part of our workload.
Let me ask you this personal recollection. The life of a trial lawyer is, of course, a fully scheduled and sometimes really adrenalinized one. The demands of a district court bench are many, and particularly the chief judge. And then to become a member of the Supreme Court and have an office, and here are three opinions to write. Was it an isolating or isolated experience to which you had to get accustomed?
You can't believe it. Can't believe how isolated I felt. It took me over a year to really get used to the isolation.
Here I was
a chief judge. I was getting, I get phone calls every day. I was just keeping the balls in the air to keep all these problems that faced us in that district. I had to keep addressing them. And here I go to the Supreme Court, and the phone doesn't ring. Nobody's in there to see me. That became pretty depressing for about a year. And I finally got used to it.
Did you wonder if you'd made the right decision?
I did wonder if I made the right decision. Sure I did. Because it was troubling to me, because I was an extrovert. I like to be around people, and that was tough.
Mm-hmm. The 1980s witnessed some further evolution of the court reorganization. I think the more centralized statewide role for the Supreme Court in the judicial branch began under Chief Justice Reynolds.
He did a marvelous job getting that done, getting the state funding for the court system.
And there was an increasing attention to administrative responsibilities. You would have been one of the justices who was here in Des Moines,
where
the legislature was located. What role evolved for you, even as a new justice to the Supreme Court?
Well, let me put it this way. In 1987, Ward Reynoldson left, and so did Chuck Woolley. They were resident. When Chuck was in Des Moines, and Ward came in from his hometown in Osceola. He was there every day. After those guys left, I was by myself. I was by myself until 1993. When Justice Turner came on the bench. So anytime a problem came up in the Supreme Court, I had to handle it. Even before I became assistant chief, I had to handle it. I did all of the budget presentations for the court. As a result, I got to know a lot of the legislators on a first-name basis, which helped later on when I became chief. I didn't have any problem mingling with these folks. Because if you're going to get any money from them, if you were going to get any money from them, you had to do that. You had to mingle with them. Because
right.
they wanted to talk to their peers, and I realized that I had to do that.
I know that as Chief Justice, you would meet fairly regularly with Governor Branstad,
right.
Governor Vilsack,
sure,
Art McGivern was the Chief Justice. Was your relationship with Chief Justice McGivern a solid one?
Yes, in fact, he was my best friend on the court. He and I are very close. I still keep in contact. In fact, I talked to him not too long ago. He had a lot of confidence in me, and just let me do my own thing. When I was there at the Supreme Court by myself, he just let me do my own thing. If I thought there was a problem, he knew I'd handle it.
Mm-hmm.
Which is great.
He was 2 hours away, wasn't he, in Ottumwa?
And he didn't have any problem, just assigning responsibility like that. That was great.
The perhaps we can talk about some of the opinions that come to mind from your period on the court. I know that. One of them, Miller versus Boone County Hospital, was involved in an issue in which Chief Justice Reynoldson, before you had been interested in taking a position. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, he fought that issue for a long, long time. And
tell us, the issue is the requirement.
Yeah, the issue, let me just kind of review this. What we did in that case, we held statute 613A5. Unconstitutional. And that statute provided at the time that if you sued a governmental entity, you had to file that lawsuit within 6 months, or if you didn't do that, you had to give notice within 60 days. And it, to me, that was just a denial of equal protection. And I wrote a dissent. I didn't think I'd get the votes. When I wrote the dissent, when our opinions were circulated. People, that's the time you write your dissent, okay? So I wrote a dissent, and lo and behold, I got all the votes. So at conference, I said, Chief, you've been fighting this issue for a long time. I said, you really ought to write this opinion. He said, no. He said, the honor is yours. You got the votes. You do it. So I did.
The case that comes to mind that we might discuss involves Wilson versus Hayes. It's a suit in which a lawyer had bought a medical malpractice case and did not prevail, and then the physicians turned and sued the lawyer for malicious prosecution.
I remember that case.
And
I think we ruled in favor of the lawyer. Is that case?
Yes, yes, you did, and it was an important case in some ways because you held that not only must there have been a dismissal of the suit, but the primary purpose of harassment had to be established
right.
independently, and so it said something about people's access to the courts.
To the court. And Hayes, a terrific trial lawyer at the time. I think he's still practicing. I'm not sure. But over in Eastern Iowa.
It seems to me that in that case was an expression of that value of providing access to the courts that you mentioned a few moments ago as one representing plaintiffs,
right.
an underdog, and if a lawyer can be intimidated from bringing the suit, some people's access to the courts will be
diminished. Right. Yeah, I remember that case now. It was a long opinion too, as I remember.
You liked research.
Yeah, that was one of the criticisms the lawyers had of me. I think I wrote too many long opinions.
Some cases, some areas were controversial. The area of protected agricultural areas. The issue of hog lots is one that the legislature has had to address. And I'm thinking of a case, Borman versus the Board of Supervisors of Kossuth County.
Yeah, what I did is I went back and looked at those 500 and some opinions and picked out about 16 of them that I thought were really important opinions, and Borman happened to be one of them. And I got some notes on Borman. It was decided in 1998. And what happened there is we held unconstitutional Section 352.11a, the immunity from nuisance suits in the hog lot area. And we said that that was a taking of property for public use without just compensation. And boy, that got a lot of publicity, I guess.
Not just in Iowa.
Yeah, and across the nation. In fact, I shepherdized it, and it had been cited more times than any of my cases across the country. And in some of these cases, they just lifted verbatim out of the opinion and into their opinion. So it was a very, very important case at the time, and worked hard on it.
As you were speaking with your friends in another branch of government, that would be the General Assembly.
Yes.
Did they have occasion to comment on your opinion in Borman?
Yeah, depending on what side of the fence they were, yeah.
Well, you mentioned a moment ago your opinion for the court in Miller versus Boone County Hospital, in which you held the state statute 613A5 unconstitutional.
Right.
Here is another instance in which you, speaking for the court, held that the statutory immunity from nuisance litigation was unconstitutional as a deprivation of property without due process and uncompensated taking. Can you speak about the reaction at the time? What was the understanding of the court's role in regard to legislation that the court, in a proper case, considered to be unconstitutional?
Well, we always took the position that, you know, you bend over backwards to uphold the constitutionality of the statute, because that is the legislature's prerogative, the legislation. But, you know, once in a while, you come across a statute that is just unconstitutional. You know it's unconstitutional. Just read it. You know it's unconstitutional.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to. You have to do your job and strike it down.
Mm-hmm.
Rarely do you do that, but occasionally you have to do that. That just happened to be one of them.
May I ask if you remember who your constitutional law professor was?
I'm trying to remember. Oh, my old Dean Tolleson.
I thought so. I knew that Dean Tolleson had taught constitutional law. Constitutional law was experiencing quite a lot of change in the period between the 50s and the 60s when you were in school. Well, I mentioned the Miller case and the Borman case because that does seem to be a really central role of the court in our constitutional scheme that is controversial today. Let me turn you to another area for a moment. And that is the role of the Supreme Court in relation to the governance of lawyers, regulation of lawyers. I'm thinking of different initiatives during your tenure on the court in which you figured prominently, and I'll give you an overview and then come back to each of them. One is in the area of trust accounts and lawyers' responsibilities. I think Iowa has a record for demanding obedience to the disciplinary rules when we had disciplinary rules. I think in your court, the ethical considerations became mandatory, not just aspirational. I know, too, that that you were the liaison justice for the Equality in the Courts Task Force. Very concerned about the perception of women and minorities of the courtroom, the atmosphere, the and I know that as a former active trial lawyer, you dealt with one of the hot issues in trial practice and over the last 3 decades, and that is the role of expert witnesses and when their testimony can be admitted. So if with that focus perhaps on the ethical rules, equality in the courts task force, and maybe housekeeping matters like procedure and rules of evidence, I can invite you to talk about the role of the Supreme Court and Justice, later Chief Justice Lavorato, in relation to the bar.
Well, the let me talk about the Equality in Courts Task Force. That was to look into the gender and minority bias in the court system.
Yes.
That was risky. I mean, we left ourselves open when we let this committee do this.
But you let everybody talk on the record.
That's right. We knew it. We knew it. But we wanted to. We wanted to find out what the problems were. And boy, there were a lot of problems, especially from the perception of women in the bar. Some of the things that lawyers were doing, male lawyers were doing to women lawyers in the courtroom, judges. We're doing things that were not professional as far as...
And the judges were not demanding certain behavior by the lawyers were treating women. And
We got actual anecdotal evidence from a lot of these women as to how they were treated. And so the perception was that women really felt that they were being... their rights were being trampled in the system. So...
What was the role of the liaison justice?
The liaison justice was to make sure that the committee got through all of those hearings and did all of the work and got the report and just kind of been ramrodder, make sure the thing got done. Mm-hmm. And then when those recommendations came before the court, of course, it was my responsibility to ramrod those recommendations, the ones that the court could agree on. I think we agreed on probably 90% of those recommendations, as I remember. And we got a lot of, I think we got some ethical rules changes because of it, and those kind of things. But I think
what changes in terms of, was there, one of the issues is education,
One of the things we did is require sensitivity training with the clerks, with the judges, with all court personnel as to these issues. And we had judges association meetings. We covered those issues. And I think today, even though we probably still have a little bit of it, because my stepdaughter probably faces a little bit of it, but not as much as we had in the past. Mm-hmm. And we hear now the women are becoming partners in law firms. That was unheard of. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Years ago. Just unheard of. They didn't do it. And maybe it's because the old white men just died off, and we got these younger guys that they went to law school with a lot of women that it just didn't bother them, you know?
Well, it's just 20 years ago, but it's quite a change for the courts, but you know, law schools and other institutions had to deal with the same issues.
Yeah.
One of the... initiatives that the court undertook was to go through every single rule of procedure and make the references gender neutral.
Gender
neutral. Is that part of that?
Yeah, gender neutral, that's true. And one of the things the court always did too is to make sure that the commissions, the appointments to the board, to the committees, Supreme Court committees were always gender neutral.
Yes.
We always made sure of that. Mm-hmm. Very careful there.
The Iowa Supreme Court nationally has stood out for insistence and enforcement to back it up on a high level of ethical behavior. And I mentioned the making the ethical considerations, which were intended to be largely aspirational, essentially mandatory, enforcing the disciplinary rules rigorously. And I think one of the opinions that you authored, the Appland case, involved trust accounts and the responsibilities of lawyers in dealing with client.
That case is really, I've got this in my notes too, that case is really a landmark case in this area. In fact, the rules that came out of that case have been enshrined in our on our ethical rules on trust accounts. And if you read the disciplinary cases today involving trust accounts, they're relying on the rules that came out of that Appland case. Rules for handling fees that were paid in advance, how to handle those fees. They have to all go into trust account. Mm-hmm. When you can take money out of a trust account, you have to earn that money and then give a notice to a client when you're going to do that. Duty to provide the client with an accounting. Duty to refund the unearned fees. All those rules, I think, became enshrined in our ethical rules in the trust account area.
You had become aware of the perceptions of women and minority of the judicial system, judges, what judges tolerated, and lawyers. Was the attention to trust accounts and the rules of professional conduct a reflection of a larger concern about the public support for the courts, public confidence in the courts and in lawyers?
Right. Yeah, that's very, very important. If the court does not enforce these disciplinary rules, the public loses confidence in the courts. That's one of the purposes for discipline. is to enhance public trust, because they know we're enforcing these rules. The Appland case was a good measure for us in that respect. Another thing that we did, and we brought a lot of controversy, I know, but we had to do it. Involved the County Attorneys Association was responsible for taking care of their own when there was some ethical violation by a prosecutor, and we delved into it, and we just felt they're not doing the job. They're not doing the job.
One of the opinions you authored was the Zener case, in which a county attorney had been accepting pleas for crimes for which there was no evidence of their being commissioned, and not a unanimous opinion. But you wrote the opinion and were quite insistent upon enforcement of the letter of the law because it reflected the larger spirit of the rules.
Right. And so then what happened was we just took that authority away from the County Attorneys Association and we just put it with our own committee. So that was very controversial. I know we got a lot of criticism, I'm sure, from the County Attorneys Association, but we had to do it.
In fact, you also centralized enforcement of lawyer discipline in the court during your tenure on the court, and particularly as Chief Justice, didn't you?
Yes. You know, that's a very, very important aspect of the court, is the enforcement of disciplinary. We take all those cases and we put them on a fast track, and they don't go to the Court of Appeals. They come. And they still do today. They come to the court, and court decides those, because that's such an important part of the court's function.
Mm-hmm. You get ahead of myself somewhat, but part of the same issue. Whose idea was it to undertake a review of the rules of professional conduct and to change from the canons? And the model code of professional responsibility to the model rules of professional conduct that we now have in Iowa?
Well, we just recognized it had to be done. You know, we just had updated rules. We had to get bring these things up current, and the best way to do that is to adopt the model rules.
What was the process you followed in doing
that? Well, originally we established a committee to do this, but they had so many changes to the model rules that the model rules weren't the model rules. So we said, hey, wait a minute. We think we better just cut it off here and just decide to, we just decided to adopt the model rules.
Mm-hmm.
And not allow any very, very minor modifications to those rules.
There was an effort to make a lot of
changes.
Some thought them appropriate. Yeah. Others saw it as erosion.
Erosion.
And
yeah, you know, the committee worked hard. They really did. And I don't want to disparage their work, but we just decided that as a policy matter, it'd be better just to adopt the model rules.
Mm-hmm.
And we did.
We've talked about specific matters, the disciplinary rules, the equality in the court's task force. The area of trust accounts is a reflection of, you know, supervision of the lawyers. Are there some cases? I know the Williams case, I think it is, about expert witnesses,
yeah.
Which is bedeviled law students and lawyers and judges, when an expert witness testimony is admissible. And the Supreme Court of the United States had spoken in the Daubert case.
Right.
You were no stranger to the courtroom, of course. You authored the Williams opinion, in which we did not follow the United States Supreme Court, did we?
Well, what really happened in that case was they tried the case under Daubert, okay? And so we had to decide the case as whether or not it met Daubert.
Mm-hmm.
And in the process, I mentioned our liberality, common law liberality in 702, which is the rule of evidence.
Right.
So I did it on a two-track basis. I did it under Daubert, and I did it under 702. So to make sure that we weren't, I pointed out, you know, we got to decide this case under Daubert because that's the way they tried it.
Mm-hmm.
But I found not only did they meet our rule under 702, but they met the Daubert rule too. Then Newman came along, which wanted to do this.
That would be Justice Newman.
Justice Newman came along, and I wanted to do this. When she said that, just because we decided this case under Daubert, we want to make sure that the people that from here on in, that's no indication that we're going to adopt Daubert, and we think that the common law rule of evidence, expert evidence under 702, the way we've developed it, is the one that we're going to follow. So she made it very, very abundantly clear that we weren't going to adopt Daubert.
That orientation, that confidence of the court to decide under Iowa law what is right for Iowa. And parting ways with the United States Supreme Court in its interpretation of the similar language,
right,
in Federal Rule 702, Federal Rule of Evidence. That's actually part of a tradition in Iowa, isn't it? Where Iowa, in a number of cases, going back to the 19th century, with, for example,
starting with Ralph.
In Ray Ralph.
Ralph. Yeah.
Can you talk about that as a something that the justices have imbued in them, that this is Iowa, we have our law, whether it's a different view of evidence or something else,
sure.
Followed up by the school did segregation opinion in Clark.
Yeah, and you know, we were always hopeful that lawyers would rely more and more on the Iowa Constitution and not the federal Constitution. Every time the lawyer would come up there, they would just cite the Iowa Constitution as an afterthought and rely on the federal Constitution. I think our thought was, hey, why don't you start relying more and more on the Iowa Constitution,
mm-hmm,
comparable provision.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the Iowa Constitution, you can give more rights under the Iowa Constitution. You can't restrict them, but you give more rights under the Iowa Constitution.
Right.
And I was always hopeful that lawyers would develop a way of really relying on the Iowa Constitution when they made their arguments in the trial court. Of course, you had to make your arguments in the trial court for preservation of error purposes. And however you raised the issue in the trial court, that's what we were bound by. So, but I always liked a lawyer that could raise an Iowa constitutional issue and not rely so much on the feds.
Well, your opinion in Williams and the route that you were describing that the court and you, who authored the opinion, and Justice Newman were describing, saying we will interpret our rules, our law, according to Iowa's values, an important position in those cases that you mentioned. Maybe I can turn your attention to another case that you and I had spoken about earlier, you brought to my attention, Hy-Vee Food Stores versus the Iowa Civil Rights Commission, one in which civil rights and minorities and access to the courts, protection of equal protection was at issue. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, that probably was my longest opinion. I think, as I remember, it probably was 50 pages, as I remember. That was my longest opinion. And went into all of the federal cases that the procedure they were adopting as far as employment discrimination cases were concerned. Two of the big issues in that case were these. One involved the whether or not disparate impact theory was going to be adopted, which we did. In other words, to prove your employment discrimination by statistics.
Yes.
We adopted that. Then the other big issue in that case is whether or not they had to prove a physical injury for emotional distress damages. And we said no, and we're going to treat emotional damages in unemployment cases just the way we treat them in personal injury cases. We're not going to require the same proof that you require an intentional infliction of emotional distress, which you have to have expert testimony actually in that area. But we said no. I think that the plaintiff can get it right up there and testify what their emotional distress was, and up to the jury to determine whether or not they're going to believe him. And today, that emotional distress element of employment discrimination cases is a real huge element in employment discrimination cases.
Mm-hmm. May I ask, recalling the experience of your dad is an immigrant, and maybe friends in the Italian community, perhaps Justice Newman's experience as a woman attorney, your experience growingly concerned about perceptions of the court, but whether you bring that experience, that learning, the values of would it be an insistence on fairness, fair treatment, equal treatment, whether that informs your understanding of a case like Hy-Vee?
Everybody brings their own experiences to the court system. And that's why it's good to have diversity on the court. Because I think you do get a better rounded decision when you have the diversity than you do if you don't. And that's why I always thought we should have women on the court, we should have minorities on the court, and it's too bad that we don't, but we don't.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope to see the day when we do have that kind of diversity again on the court.
It even recently, as you may know, the question of the value of a woman's perspective on a
very valuable
unemployment discharge and alleged discrimination because she was found.
Yeah, you know, you'd have a woman on the court and say, "Hey, you guys, you don't understand. This is the way it is with women." I mean, you know, that's the kind of.
And probably men's experience is different. Isn't
it is different. Sure, and that's why it's important to have women on the court.
Let me turn to another case that was not one in which you authored, but it you were in the majority opinion in it, and it picks up on some themes that we've mentioned, and one of those themes is what you said, a willingness, a disposition to look to the Iowa Constitution, not as constrained by interpretations of the federal Constitution, and a strong civil rights tradition. You mentioned the N. Ray Ralph. I think that was the first opinion and of the Iowa court when it was when we were a territory. It was a 1839 opinion.
I think public accommodation before the Supreme Court. We had desegregation of schools before the Supreme Court.
On the basis of the Iowa Constitution.
That's right.
I'm thinking of the Racy opinion, particularly the Racy opinion on remand from the U.S. Supreme Court, and your comments about the Daubert opinion, and say to the lawyers, look, we have our own rule and our own interpretation, and we're not going to be constrained or directed by federal court interpretations of federal rules. We have our own. In Racy, I'll let you talk about
the case. Racy, of course, the U.S. Supreme Court knocked us out when we said that it was a violation. I think it was equal protection that was involved in that case.
Casinos were being taxed at 36% and boats at 20%.
And that was a down of equal protection. And the Supreme Court said, no, not under the federal constitution. And the problem in that case, when we first decided it, we decided it under the federal constitution. And as I remember, there was an issue on the Iowa Constitution, but we decided under the federal constitution was a big mistake, because that allowed them to go to the U.S. Supreme Court. If we had decided it under the Iowa Constitution, that would have been the end of the case. So when it came back, we said, well, we're going to decide this case under the Iowa Constitution. And of course, our counterpart of the equal protection, the immunities clause, it provides a better protection than the federal equal protection clause.
And that
became very important later on. But go ahead.
This was an opinion we talked about, Miller, in which you held the 60-day notice requirement unconstitutional, and we talked about Borman, in which you held that the nuisance immunity was an unconstitutional taking because without just compensation. Here in Racy, you were holding state legislated tax differentials constitutional under the Iowa Constitution.
Yeah, we caught a lot of flack for that, too.
And I know that you were meeting at that time with the legislature on the court's budget, and there was a lot of controversy.
A lot of controversy. Yeah, they.
Can you talk about those controversies and conversations?
Well, they would they wouldn't say it directly to us. It'd come back to us secondhand. Quit messing with our statutes. And didn't particularly like it. And it also depended on who side of the fence you were on, as far as the casinos were concerned. So we caught a lot of flack about that. I remember where there was even some editorial, some cartoons about that decision. And there were some heated comments coming from
what's the role of... what's the awareness of the need for courage in a judge?
And this is a real important issue today because of the attack on the judiciary. You cannot be looking over your shoulder as a judge. You got to make that decision and not look back. Uh-huh. You got to have the courage to do that. And there are times when I read a statute, I hated it. It was disgusting, but it was the legislature. This is what they wanted, and I just held my nose and wrote the opinion. Mm-hmm. Why? I mean, that's part of the rule of law. You do what you
It wasn't unconstitutional, so that was what, that's not your role.
Then we're not the policymakers. Legislature is the policymaker. Mm-hmm. And so you got to have that kind of courage. You can't be result-oriented. You got to be... intellectually honest, and do what's right.
Mm-hmm. The courage, of course, for courts cannot be a sometime thing. I know that among your many honors, Chief, is a Herbert Harley Award from the American Judicature Society because of the... your consistent stance as a lawyer and a justice and a chief justice for the independence of the judicial branch and the insistence upon fair and impartial justice. I'd like to read from your final State of the Judiciary address a couple portions which struck me as timeless as well as timely. And you were speaking to the need of the judiciary, if it was to fulfill its role, for its independence to be recognized and protected. And you said, and I'll take different portions, Iowa's high standing is in large part a result of its merit selection process for appointing judges, because merit selection emphasizes professional qualifications above all else. Judges possess the attributes most valued in judges: fairness, integrity, legal excellence, civility, diligence, and prudence. And as I read that portion, I think of your comments a moment ago about Governor Branstad appointing a pretty liberal Democrat to the court, and about the court, not even you and Chief Justice Reynolds, and even nobody ever talked politics.
Never talked politics.
Let me go on. I'm all for vigorous public debate regarding the merits of judicial decisions and the role of the courts, you told the legislature in your address. But the quality of discourse about the courts has degenerated, rather than legitimate criticism and thoughtful commentary intended to inform and enlighten. The public is barraged with rash generalization, loaded soundbites, and alarmist overstatements intended to exploit and inflame. The sole purpose of these tactics is to politicize our courts so the judges are servants of popular ideologies rather than servants of the law. These attacks are designed to weaken the very institution Americans rely on to uphold the Constitution and protect their rights. It's time to replace the excessive rhetoric with plain facts and measured responses. And I want to use this as a lead to, I think you got two or three standing ovations in that address.
Yeah, I did.
The Des Moines Register and other newspapers applauded your comments. They recognized the need. We know from recent politics that what you foretold was
coming.
It was coming, and even then, fact, and it's why the American Judicature Society honored you with its Herbert Harley Award.
We were real close court. You know, we would, if you had a problem, you could call another justice and talk about what you shoot ideas off them and get some feedback. We were real close, very close. Collegiality was great. Why? Because we were not a political court. You get into some of these states, and I heard this stuff from judges in states where the appellate courts were elected. They would love to have our kind of system, but too many moneyed interest groups prevented it, and still prevent it today. But in any event, you get to these courts that are so politicized, you have factions on the court. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't even talk to each other. That was not our court, and I attribute that basically to the fact that we were not in politics.
Let me tell you a story that our current Chief Justice, Mark Cady, shared with me.
Sure.
Chief Justice Cady said, Chief Justice Lavorato was, I think he said, his Italian heritage was apparent, and the Chief Justice was a really vigorous, strong arguer in our conferences, and tough. But after the decision to Maine, we were best friends.
Sure.
And he was alluding to a case out of Davenport in which you had found that you had taken steps to protect the rights of an accused in a criminal case, saying, I think that a confession obtained under a promise of leniency was inherently unreliable.
Inherently unreliable, yep.
And you were protecting the rights of the accused. Can you talk about that?
Yes, that in fact, in that case, we reaffirmed an old rule. We said this issue is not going to be one of a constitutional nature. We're going to use this as a rule of evidence that a confession obtained by promises of leniency is just inherently unreliable, and that's we're going to just suppress those confessions on that basis. And he and I went around and around and around on that case, and fought long and hard in conference. But as I remember, I think I answered all of his objections in orally in conference. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I don't think he dissented in that case. I think he was satisfied with my arguments. But no, we went on a tooth and nail in that conference. But we emerged good friends. We're still good friends today.
Oh, he said best friends. He has yeah. great respect and as we talked, because you know the current chief has written about professionalism and co-authored a book on ethics and professional responsibility, and we commented that being a vigorous advocate, being a lawyer, is not inconsistent with being civil. And
right.
And I know that, that tradition of civility within the profession of law is one that was personally important, is one that he was witnessing in your conferences, and he thought it was a real testimony to you. Can you talk about civility in the profession?
Yeah, the court early on in my, when I first got onto the court, we decided we were going to have a civility code, because that was the big thing in the Bar Association, was a civility code, because at that period of time there was a lot of hardball going on around the country, and we didn't want Iowa lawyers to become Rambo type lawyers. We didn't want that in Iowa, so we devised an idea to come up with the code of civility. That's what I call it anyway. And it defined relationships between lawyers and lawyers, lawyers and litigants, lawyers and judges, judges to lawyers, and judges among themselves. Now, these were aspirational. They were not, you couldn't use these as a violation, an ethical violation. They were aspirational. In other words, one of the rules, I remember, if you're going to take a default, always notify the lawyer you're going to take a default. Don't just set a deposition without, as I remember, without calling the lawyer. And it just common sense, everyday, golden rule type rules. And we still have that code of civility. And as I remember, I think Celeste Bremer, one of our federal jurists, told me that she uses that civility code in her dealings with lawyers in the federal court system. But they're aspirational. But I would always hope, and it was always my hope, that before a lawyer would ever be able to take the oath, that he or she would read that civility code and know what is expected of them.
Chief, let me follow up on a comment that you made in regard to the rules of civility, particularly in regard to the taking of defaults. Actually, there was a decision of the Iowa Supreme Court before you were appointed to the court in which someone took a default and waited for a year, so the much more onerous standard, I think under it was then Rule 252, would apply rather than 236. Can you talk about taking in defaults as an aspect of professional practice and civility?
Let me just give you a story. I was always against taking a default against a lawyer. Always against it. I had an associate, I won't mention his name, but John McClintock and I had a lot of cases together. He was on the defense side, I was on the plaintiff. And I always admired John, great lawyer. And this associate came in one day and he said, "Guess what?" I said, "What?" I just took a default against John McClintock. I said, you what? I immediately said, you know how many open files I got? Do you know what John can do to me? What goes, you know, the old rule, what goes around comes around. It's just inappropriate. I said, look, here's what you do. You go down to court and withdraw the motion for default and get that thing set aside. And then you call John McClintock and you apologize to him. And he did. Mm-hmm. That's how sensitive I was as far as defaults were concerned, especially against lawyers. So I had this case on appeal. And this lawyer, I won't mention his name, but he had taken a default against the lawyer. And I was incensed, and I tried to hold my temper, and I think I did a pretty good job, but I kind of laid into him. And after that was all said and done, I just said to the court, we're going to change the rule. We're going to require that there be a 10-day waiting period before you got to give notice, and then it got to be a 10-day waiting period before you take a default if there's no response. And it passed. And
there's a client behind that lawyer, isn't there?
Yeah, yeah. And that's how the rule came into effect. Mm-hmm. And then Dave Ellerkin, God bless him, wrote an op-ed piece extolling the virtues of that rule and just saying, you know, it's just awful the way it used to be as far as taking defaults was concerned. Because it put a lawyer in a dilemma. You know, what do I do? I got to represent my client? Or do I act professionally? What do I do here? If the client is insisting I take the default. But this default rule now, I think, kind of takes the lawyer off the hook.
Let me follow up further. It seemed to me, looking at the Iowa trial bar over a number of decades, as I had the opportunity to do in my role as dean, because so many Drake alumni were trial lawyers, I always thought that Chief Justice Moore's trial practice course had something to do with that, and then the trial bar itself was a pretty close community. You would travel statewide, and whether it was you and Bob Albee or Franny Fitzgibbons or Ed Gallagher
they told you something, and then you didn't have to worry about putting it in writing or anything. It's right. Handshake, it was done.
Is there a sense that you have, as someone who's observed lawyers from your graduation in 62 to over a 50-year period, is that sense of community within the bar challenged, and what can individual lawyers, I know you established the bench bar conferences, maybe you could talk about that, but it seems that civility is an aspect of our relations to one another that is important to you.
Well, you know, I'm doing a lot of mediations now, and I do hear complaints from lawyers in my mind, they're not really, some of these lawyers are not really acting within the spirit of our civility code. Mm-hmm. Not a lot of them, but some. And I don't think we have the problem in this state that we do in other states when it comes to hardball tactics. But there is some of it. And I know the law school tries to teach students, about our civility code. I'm sure you guys cover
that. We do. If I might follow your reference to the law school, as a professor for several decades and dean twice, I take this opportunity to thank you for your continuing relationship that I know actually began while you were still in practice and taking a young lawyer on while a law student, George LaMarca. And mentoring him and maybe letting him try a case.
Yeah, I got a story about old George LaMarca and how this led to the development of the student practice rule.
Yeah, we have a thriving clinic and we wouldn't have it without that student practice rule.
I had a dog of a case and George wanted to try it. I don't think there's any problem in you trying it. And I said, but I'm going to have to second chair you because I'm sure the judge, and it was Oxberger, who was a trial judge, and I, I said, I'm just going to have to second chair you because the court's going to want to, you know, you're not a lawyer, so I better be down there with you and second chair you when you do this. And lo and behold, he won the case. And there was a newspaper article about it, and then eventually that led to the passage of the student practice rule. That's how that happened. I mentored a lot of good trial lawyers that are operating here today. Mark Cucci, Dave Wiggins, who eventually came on the court and was on the court at the same time I was.
Well, you have also, before you were Chief Justice, we began a process of swearing in our students under the student practice rule.
Right.
We probably 60% or 70% of our class now takes clinical courses, and they are admitted to practice under the student practice rule, which you are referencing, and you would administer the oath and come and speak to that. So you've had quite a long relationship with our students.
A lot of pictures downstairs in the office here surrounding those swearing-in ceremonies. Yeah,
absolutely. Your stepdaughter and your daughter,
right,
are both part of the Drake family too. Is there voice or advice that you would give to us in legal education but also fellow members of the bar about shepherding this sense of civility and community that you described?
Yeah, if you want to develop cohesiveness in the Bar Association, we've got to have this sense of civility in the bar. We have to have it. And if we lost that, then I think we're in trouble. And the law schools can really, really help in that direction by inculcating in these students the necessity for civility in the practice of law. Very, very important. I can remember another story. I can remember when I first got on the Supreme Court, Professor Powers, when he was teaching law here, came to me and he said, I got a great idea. He said, because he knew that I took Drake students when I was a trial judge, right? Mm-hmm. And had him intern. Didn't pay him anything, but had him intern. And his idea was, look, why don't you do the same thing here at the Supreme Court? Take these students on as interns, and we'll give them credit. We'll give them credit as long as you tell us that they're doing the work and you think what they're doing is satisfactory. So I did. And then I think that developed. I think I started also a program for minority students. Mm-hmm. Try to keep some of the minority students here in that process. So that's how we developed the internship program here.
We have a very strong judicial internship program too, and it did develop under Professor Power, and I know you had a number of judicial interns when you were at Polk County. On the district court bench, and of course as a justice and Supreme Court justice too. As we look at challenges that whether it's in those in practice, those in teaching, those on the bench face for the future, one of the issues always is resources, budgetary resources, and a couple things I'll mention. I know that during your early years as chief, you had to speak candidly to the court, to the legislature about the possible need to close or reduce hours in county clerk's offices.
Yeah, we laid off about 187 people back in 2000 because of the budget crunch.
And even now, the Supreme Court clerk's office is on 2 days out of the week, only open through 2 o'clock. And is not open the whole time. Members of the court have not heard cases on Friday, so the issue, the challenge of resources and the relationship with the legislature, that suggests, and what that means to people's access to the courts. You know, one of your answers was expanded use of technology. I wonder if you could talk about the challenge of limited resources and then what the court itself, which you were applauded for being willing to do, can accomplish to make resources stretch.
As I mentioned earlier on in my conversation, I gave the budget presentations for the court even before I became assistant chief. So I developed a rapport with legislators, which I think really helped a lot of situations, probably kept the situation from getting worse, because I did take it upon myself to meet with the legislative leaders and open, keep the doors of communication open. I had a wonderful relationship with Stu Iverson, the Republican majority leader in the Senate at the time, Chris Rantz, the Speaker of the House at the time. They understood my problems. They tried to make sure the court got adequate funding, but it was tough. We were in a budget subcommittee with the justice and with the prison system, so you know, most of that money went to the prison system. So we were second or third in line for money, and try to figure out ways where we could maybe have our own subcommittee, appropriations subcommittee, to just focus on the courts. We tried a lot of things to see if we could get more money. And the problem, as I see it, in my experience, is we don't have any chips with the legislature. We can't spend anything with the legislature. We can't. Oh, we got our opinions. We can't do that. Mm-hmm. So we got nothing left.
And some of those opinions, like Miller and Borman and Racy, are not seen like dessert.
That's
they?
Right. They're not. We still got to do our job, you know. So I always thought it was imperative for the Chief Justice to meet regularly with the leadership on both sides of the aisle, and I did that. You have to do that. I think Mark's doing that today, and it's imperative. The Chief's got to do that. I didn't find that to be displeasing as far as dealing with these folks. In fact, some of them became very good friends, like Stu Iverson. I could always talk to him. I could go in there and walk in his office and put him up on the desk and talk to him straight, man to man, you know?
Uh-huh.
And the same thing with Chris Rantz. I had developed a real good relationship with him.
Right. That ability to talk across the aisle is important, isn't it?
Yeah.
If
you remember, Chris Rantz wrote an op-ed piece saying that the court was not wrong in the same-sex marriage case.
Right.
And here's a guy that is a staunch Republican who doesn't approve of same-sex marriage.
No.
But understands what the job of the courts is.
Well, as Speaker, he recalled the courts striking down an action by then Governor Vilsack, didn't
he? That's right. That's right.
And so I do remember that opinion, that and those relationships, that understanding are unfortunately too few, and the understanding of the court's role pretty challenged, and as the atmosphere has become charged politically.
Yeah, you know, if you meet face to face with these individuals, it's hard pressed for them, and you develop good relations with them, it's hard pressed for them to say, well, you know, they just did that as a slap in the face. No, that's not why we did it, and they understand that.
So it was in this atmosphere, Chief, that you fought for and obtained what is a great symbolic and architectural landmark for the state of Iowa for probably a century and more to come, which is the Iowa Judicial Branch Building, and not an easy time in our budgetary history. Oh. And at a time when opinions like Racy were coming down the pike, and Elon's might have been in the offing. It was decided later, of course, but the awareness of the issue went back to the 90s.
Yeah, we, as I said, Chief Justice McGivern delegated the authority. He was not afraid to delegate authority, and he gave me the job. He said, you run with this. You get this done. And he appointed me and Bill O'Brien, the then state court administrator, as co-chairs of the building committee. We had Justice Turnus on that committee. We had David Boyd, assistant state court administrator, and Becky Colton, the executive assistant, on that building committee. We met with our architects for 2 years. We started in 98 and we finished in 2000 when they broke ground. We met with them we met twice a month with them just to get the building designed. Mm-hmm. As far as the infighting is concerned on the money situation, I had a real good ally in the House of Representatives, Representative Gipp, who really helped me as far as the funding was concerned.
Representative Gipp?
Gipp. Mm-hmm. And at that time, we had open dialogue with the legislature. They wanted us out of the Capitol building in the worst way. And Chief Justice Moore could never, he had an agreement with them, a written agreement. They would never be booted out of the Capitol building. And one of the legislators said, well, you know, that's not a binding agreement. And the chief's remark was, who do you think is going to make that decision? So in any event, there was...
That was a chip.
Yeah. There was a strong resistance by court members before my time to ever, ever leave the Capitol building. I had a different view. My view is, why? We're a separate and co-equal branch of government. Why do we want to be in this Capitol building? Why aren't we in our own building? Which would give the impression that we are a separate co-equal branch of government. And so I wasn't that resistant to moving out of the building. But to do that, they were going to have to pay a price. So they wanted to put us in the old historical building. I said, nah, you do that, we're going to run out of space before we ever get over there. We want our own building. We want a new building.
The judicial branch is pretty far. You had commissions and different buildings.
Yeah, different buildings. We're paying rent, and we wanted all those functions under one roof. And so they said, "Okay, what do you want a new building? Anything else? Yeah, we want to restructure the Supreme Court." They said, "What do you mean? We want to go to the model that the American Bar Association has." Suggest we want to go from 9 members to 7 members because we were in divisions, and my impression of being in divisions, you got inconsistent decisions. Mm-hmm. That was one way to eliminate this idea of inconsistent divisions because every justice had to read every brief and argument that came before the court on a particular case, and was familiar with those cases. Whereas in divisions, it wasn't that necessary. So it was imperative that we reduced our numbers so we didn't have to sit in divisions.
The court sat in a panel of 5, didn't it?
Yes.
And so you'd have 4 justices not serving on a particular panel who wouldn't read those opinions.
That's right. So that's why we got inconsistent opinions, I think, in my estimation. So I thought that was a good idea, too. And so they agreed, okay, we'll give you your own building. And we'll allow you to reduce the court from 9 to 7. And then it became a fight as to where we were going to put the building. And the Capitol Planning Commission has the authority to determine where new buildings are going to be put on the Capitol campus. Okay? Mm-hmm. So Gipp told me, now you're going to have to go over there and convince that Capitol Planning Commission about the space that you want, because the engineers or the architects for the Capitol Planning Commission want to put your building right in the middle of all those monuments. No, I want that piece of ground across the street. And when the Register got wind of it, well, they wrote an editorial just blistering me, because They thought that that should remain prairie ground, I guess. I don't know. But they didn't think it was a good idea to put the judicial branch building there. Later on, when the building was finally erected and everything was going smoothly, they wrote another editorial and said that was the best place to put it. But in any event, I had to go over there at the Capital Planning Commission to argue for that piece of ground. And I had to go, and I brought my architects, of course, and used them as my expert witnesses. And they voted. But I won that argument by one vote. So that's how we got the ground across the street.
How many were on the Capital Planning Commission?
Oh, I think there were five, as I remember. It could have been more, but it was a real. It was close, and we had a lawyer on there, and I won't tell you his name, and he voted against us. He voted against us.
Did he ever win another case?
I love a hell of an advocate like that. He'd get a lawyer to go with me.
Well, let me talk further about the building of the symbol, because you have championed at different times the transparency of the judicial branch, the accessibility to justice that must be a hallmark of the judicial branch and constitutional governments. And I've heard you speak about the building as a public building. You've invited the public to it, and you took a number of initiatives, and I'm thinking somewhat of the court's 21st century long-range planning commission, which noted the need for transparency, which said that access to justice was a critical feature of constitutional governance, and something which was the court's responsibility to champion. And
may I just interrupt at this point?
Absolutely.
That report was my Bible. That's what I followed as Chief Justice. I just stuck to that thing because I thought the recommendations were just excellent for us to get through. And I think we need another one of those examinations.
You followed a number of those.
It was my Bible.
I've got the Charting the Future of Iowa's Courts, the report of the Iowa Supreme Court Commission on Planning for the 21st Century. A couple of the recommendations dealt with access and transparency, also public education about law and the role of the courts, protection of our merit system.
Minorities,
respect and access for...
That's how we got our court interpreter provision.
Initiatives for access to justice, online access to records,
right.
Cameras in the courtroom. Interpreters.
I got to tell you another story.
Unbundling legal services.
I have to tell you another story about the cameras in the courtroom.
Please.
This is when the issue first came up, and I get this murder case, and the Register and Tribune wanted to have the cameras in the courtroom, and I was adamantly against it at first because I was a trial judge. And I didn't want anything interrupting my proceedings. So I had to defend it. It's a murder case, first degree. He wasn't going to come to court if we had cameras in the courtroom. So I wrote a decision keeping the cameras out of the court. Of course, the Register and Tribune immediately appealed the thing to the Iowa Supreme Court. And of course, there was a division, I found out later, on the court itself. And McGivern was on my side. And argued vociferously for me, and Jerry Larson, of course, he was in the opposite camp because he was all for cameras in the courtroom.
He's former prosecutor.
Yeah. Anyway, I won the decision. I was able to keep the cameras out of the courtroom. But later, I became a fan of the courts and the cameras in the court system. I didn't have any problem with it. The organization that was responsible for maintaining the order in the courtroom as far as cameras were concerned, they did a marvelous job. I even used the camera one time in a criminal case. The coroner testifying in a criminal case, death case, a murder case, and the defense objected because he evidently claimed that he made some kind of a motion and said something that was prejudicial to the defendant. So I said to the camera people, play it back for me, let me see it. And they did. And I was able to overrule that that objection. So I ultimately became a fan of gamblers in the courtroom.
Well, it is a key issue enabling the public to see justice and the courts at work and understand what they do and understand that it is not just, you know, calling balls and strikes, but it is an exercise in judgment in real time.
You see, you got to, if you're going to have confidence in the courts, as far as the public is concerned, you're going to let the courts see what's going on in the courtroom.
What
and
about
this court watcher program that they've got going right now locally? I think that's a good idea. You know, let the public be aware and be watchful of what's going on in the courts, because this builds confidence in the courts. The judge is doing a good job. They're gonna see that.
Can you speak further about public access to the work of the courts? I'm thinking of the website, online access to records.
The online access to records has been a tremendous advantage for employers. For example, I mean, they used to have to go to the clerk's office to get these things by, go dig through the files and get all this information about a person's background. All they have to do now is go online and they got it.
Uh-huh.
It's a wonderful tool. We also did the streaming of arguments in the Supreme Court, if you remember.
Yes, you did.
And of course, I think they discontinued it for a while because of money issues.
And now
they're
back.
Doing it again.
Yes.
So that was another thing that was giving access.
People can observe the oral arguments as they are occurring.
As they are occurring. And that was another idea. And then we had, on May Day, when we moved over to the new court building, we opened the doors to the public, have them come in, talk to the justices, see that, you know, we're human beings just like they are, and answer their questions. And I think that's a good thing. I don't know if they're still doing that or not.
I believe they do. They do have open houses.
Okay.
And part of the Long Range Planning Commission was to take the work of the court outside of Des Moines and central Iowa.
We did that in 1999, the remodeling the Capitol building at the time, and we had to move out of there, so we decided, what the heck, we'll just travel and it's the various cities. And
what was it like having court in other cities around Iowa?
It was amazing. It was really an eye-opener for me. It really was.
How so?
Well, you got these people coming in to hear. I mean, it's just not Des Moines folks coming in to hear. You got these folks from outer areas coming in to listen to you talk. And then the newspaper picks it up, the local newspaper picks it up, and talks about it. That's tremendous good publicity for the courts.
You have students coming.
Students coming.
People tell their friends, and it was a big deal. Right now, the court is working with the implementation of the electronic data management system. That was something that initiated a pilot project under your watch as chief.
We had the money to do it. Back in, I think it was 2000, between 2000 and 2002, we had the money to start. And the legislature and the governor decided that they needed the money. And they took our money that we had set aside for this system. So it was delayed, and they're making good progress on it today, though. This is going to be a tremendous boost as far as the practice of law is concerned.
Let me pick up on another aspect of resources, relations between the court and the legislature, understanding of the public for the work of the court and the role of the judge, and including the courage to stand alone at times and strike down legislation. I had the pleasure of serving on the Blue Ribbon Commission on Judicial Compensation. The role of compensating, you know, judges is not one generally appreciated, I think, and the merit selection system is under challenge nationwide, and even in Iowa, it is at stake in the recent elections. Can you talk about the merit selection and the compensation of justice? Those are two different issues, but you stood staunchly in favor of, you know, competitive compensation for judges and what that meant to the people of Iowa and the judicial branch. Can you tell about
that? Yeah, I started that process when I was a trial judge. I was a legislative chairperson for the Judges Association, John Maurer and I. And that was our big deal to get benefits such as pay increases and pension taken care of. We fought those battles with the legislature. Today we've got a good pension system. Pays out a heck of a lot better than it did when I first got on the court. And the pay system, as I remember this Blue Ribbon Commission, I always wanted business people to be involved. And I think business people are very essential to the improvement of the court system. I wanted guys that knew what it took to get good people, and what it took as far as pay is concerned to get good people. And they understood. So you get the top business people together in the Blue Ribbon Commission,
right,
and you know what they're going to say.
Who were your chairs?
Oh, I'm trying to remember. We had Bob Ray was the chairperson. Former Governor Ray was the chairperson, as I remember. You got the list.
Marv Pomerantz.
Marv Pomerantz. I got to tell you a story.
Marvin Pomerantz and Bob Ray were co-chairs.
I got to tell you a story about old Marv. Marv, I love Marv. Marv and I were good friends, even though he was a Republican and I was a Democrat. And I said to him, I said, Marv, how in the world did you ever become a Republican? You had all these people in your family and your background and everything. I would just assume that you'd be a Democrat. He said, Lou, he said, this is what happened. He says, part of the family decided they were going to be Republicans, and then part of the family decided we were going to be Democrats. That's how that happened. And I can remember one time when he was a staunch defender of the court system. He was a staunch defender. And I can remember one time we had a bill that was going to give us a number of judges. Okay, and we needed judges desperately at that time. And there was a threat by Governor Branstad to veto the bill. So I called Marvin, and I got him on his plane. He was going somewhere. He called me back. He said, what's wrong? I said, I need to have you call Terry and tell him not to veto that judge's bill. We need these judges desperately. He got on the horn and called Terry and got the job done. And
we really?
That's the kind of guy that he was. But you have these other business people here, Jim Conning. We had Carolyn. I didn't know we had Dean Jones on. You were on there too, weren't you?
I was.
Bill Knapp, Knapp Properties. Dwayne McInnish of McInnish Corporation. Marshall Nichols, who was the lobbyist for the Ask Me group. Marv, of course, Marv Pomerantz. Sandra Rasmussen of the Rasmussen Group. And you were on there, of course. And we had Jerry Crawford that was really pushing this thing hard for us. He was our liaison.
Right.
He and Nick Critelli were our liaison people.
The quality of the bench is important. You need to have people with the ability, the competence,
right,
the integrity, the courage.
Well, that plan was in a three-stage process. We were going to get a raise first year, and then another raise the second year, then we're supposed to get another raise in the third year. We got the raise in the first year, we got the raise in the second year. In the third year, it didn't go through.
Uh-huh.
But it almost went through. We were in the final days of the legislature, and I called Rance. It was in the House. Bill was in the House, and said, Chris, see if you can get that thing through for us. We desperately need to get that through for us. And he said, I'll see what I can do. And he came back later. It's just against you. You're not going to get it done. But at least he tried.
Right.
And that's how that all came to be. And I don't know if the judges have ever gotten a pay raise since then or not. I'm not aware.
The importance of personal relations with people, in the House, in the Senate, in the legislature, in the
very important
in the business community. It's important for the court not to be isolated, isn't it?
Today, if, for example, the Polk County courthouse issue, if you're familiar with that.
Yes.
They're having a terrible time getting a new courthouse. Well, my idea is forget about lawyers doing the work here. the groundwork. Lawyers can lead it, but forget about them doing the groundwork. Get business people behind you. Get the business community behind you on this courthouse and the need for a courthouse, because courts are very, very important when it comes to the business. They are.
Absolutely.
And the business people realize that.
Right.
And I think the same thing with this judicial retention. You got to get the business community behind the judges on this judicial retention, because they have tremendous influence. Why? Because, you know, our court system has been ranked, what, in the top five as far as fairness and
impartiality.
Impartiality as far as the National
Efficiency.
Chamber of Commerce. Well, you don't think business looks at that? They
right.
do. There are states where they're afraid to go to because of how unfair the atmosphere is to business. But here, it's fair.
Were active in the National Conference of Chief Justices, as I am recalling, and so you were spoken with your colleagues at the top in other states where there are judicial elections. What's the impact of having to be elected as a judge on the willingness of good people such as yourself to step forward and apply for a judgeship?
Well, I never would have applied for a judgeship if I had to do it through politics. Number one, I don't think I could ever have been elected because of my name and at the time. And two, I just had a disdain for politics. I was not a political person.
You'd have to raise money somehow.
You'd have to raise money, yeah. And I always give lay people this real easy to understand situation when it comes to electing judges versus the merit selection that we have. I say that, you just imagine a judge is on the bench and he's got two lawyers sitting at the counsel table, and he knows one lawyer hasn't contributed to his campaign and he knows the other lawyer has. I said, what do you think that judge is going to do? Or what he's going to be, or he or she is going to be tempted to do?
Mm-hmm.
I said, we don't have that problem.
No.
We don't have that problem.
No. What do you think that... you get the business community, is there work for others? I know the Register has been staunch in its support of the merit system, but it's really crucial, isn't it, not to have justices at the front end or the back end, and having to defend themselves against charges that they acted out of ideology or that they usurped the Constitution. The comment was made that the Varnum Court unconstitutionally amended the Constitution.
Yeah. Civics 101, these people need to go back and take up Civics 101 and understand. I think today there's a mindset to just ignore the facts, I don't care how much you argue to them. They've got their own idea, and that's the way it's going to be. They're just going to ignore the facts.
You were always insistent on accountability of the judiciary, and whether it's in the budget or in other ways. And I think in your last judiciary address, you mentioned different ways, and even this morning in our conversation, you said if the court can avoid a constitutional question, it will.
It will.
And if it's a matter of interpretation of a statute with which the legislature disagrees, the legislature can amend the statute
right.
and legislative overrule the court.
And they have done it many times.
And they have.
Yeah.
And if it's...
I wouldn't say many times, but on occasion they have, yeah.
But if it's a matter of interpreting the Constitution and holding legislation unconstitutional, as you did in the Miller case, the 60-day notice case, you did in the Borman case, the nuisance immunity case, the unequal tax between casinos and Prairie Meadows, Racy, or the court did in Varnum, The method of accountability is to amend the Constitution.
Amend the Constitution.
And not, is it a misuse of that retention vote, do you think, to focus on an opinion and politicize the bench that
terrible,
way?
Terrible, terrible, terrible situation. It's sad, really sad. I never, ever thought I'd see the day when I first went on the Supreme Court that a justice would have to go out and defend himself or herself against this kind of, against this criticism.
You saw that coming with Judge Neary in the Allen case,
didn't you? I saw it coming
in
that case, yeah.
Uh-huh. Though what you greatly feared came to pass.
Came to pass.
Uh-huh. The you're doing a lot of mediation now.
Yeah.
There is the only retirement is work. It seems for and I know that
I'm getting back to my roots.
It's been you're doing a lot of mediation. What are lessons of from your experience as a mediator that you can share with us, both about your personal philosophy for lawyering and your the role of law?
You know, it's the same thing, same philosophy as a judge. Fairness, key. Being fair is key. You know, listening, patience. Got to have a little compassion too. You know,
uh-huh.
You just can't be a dead fish when you're doing these mediations. Uh-huh. And when people ask you for opinions, be honest about your opinions. Be forthright. Don't try to, say something just to get the case settled. You have to discuss strengths and weaknesses of the cases with the parties and the attorneys. And many times I'll tell a client something, and the lawyer will tell me later, I told them the exact same thing you're telling them.
Uh-huh.
And mediation to me, and and there's a tension between mediation and, of course, the jury system. You know that. We've got a terrible problem today because we're settling so many cases that nobody's getting any trial experience as far as the jury process is concerned. And I know that's a big problem with mm-hmm. lawyers. Mm-hmm. How do you train these people?
Federal and state.
Yeah, we didn't have mediations when I was a trial lawyer. I'd go down and sit with an associate mentor him and let him try the case, and maybe three or four times, and then he or she's on it on their own.
Well, I think your colleague from law school, Dale Petticard, would like you to try probably thousands of yeah. cases, and now Dale too is engaged in mediation. Mm-hmm. Do people prefer to have it settled if they can be heard and they think the result is fair?
If you would, as a mediator, what I always try to do, opening up the session, of course I give a little pep talk at the beginning, is how the process is going to work. And I'm always looking straight into their eyes, talking to them, and trying to build a rapport and trust with these folks right from the beginning. And that, I think, is very, very important for a mediator. You got to build that trust with both sides if you're going to get the matter resolved.
Uh-huh.
Very, very important. I got to tell you another little story about one of my law professors before I end this thing. It's an interesting one. You remember Dick Hudson?
Oh, I do.
Contracts. He was my contract professor.
Relentless and a relentless questioner.
our first contract exam, he gave us cartoons, and we had to pick out the issues out of the cartoons and write on the issues that we picked out of the cartoons. But he was tough, really tough, and all of us were scared to death of it. All of us. Bob Albee told me one time, when he was on the bench, he saw Dick Hudson come in to the courtroom in Supreme Court, and he was scared to death. Anyway, I'm in the trial. I was trying a case down as a trial judge down in Polk County one day, and I see Dick Hudson walk into the courtroom. I said to myself, why is he here? What's he doing? So after I get off the bench, I go up to him and shake hands with him. I said, is there anything I could do today? What's the deal? He said, I want to work for you. I said, Dick, I can't pay you. He said, I don't care. I just want to work for you. I want to be part of the process. I said, okay. So the first project I gave him was a small claims appeal involving a court and satisfaction. He wrote me a 20-page opinion. On accord and satisfaction. As it turned out, he stayed with me until he came down with prostate cancer, and he had to leave town and go be with his family in Miss Wisconsin, I think it was.
He had been your contracts professor?
Yeah, and he wanted to go to the Supreme Court with me because he knew I was trying to get on the court as a, and I would have done it. I'd have had him up here with me, but he couldn't make it. He passed away not too long after that.
Uh-huh. Chief, this has been a wonderful conversation. Thinking that I'd like to ask you, is there anything that I haven't brought out that or given you the opportunity to say? Is there any question I haven't asked about that I should have?
Well, I want to straighten out a couple of misconceptions people have about the judicial branch building. Our funds came from the infrastructure fund, not from general funds.
Right.
So, and those infrastructure funds could never be used for general expenses. Couldn't be. And people always were saying, you know, why don't they use that money? We're having a hard time. Why don't they use that money to employ people and put people back to work and that kind of thing? We could never use that money for that purpose. And, you know, it withstood a lot of criticism for that. But I kept thinking to myself, 10, 15, 20 years from now, these folks will look back on that building. It's a 100-year building. They'll look back on that building and they'll say, best thing they ever did. And I talked to the architects after we moved in, 2 years later, and I said to them, how much do you think this building would cost to build a day? And they said $60 million. It cost us $30. But it cost $60 million at that time to build that building. So I think it was a great decision, even though we got a lot of criticism because of it at the time. It proved out to be the right thing to do.
It's a symbol of brought back a lot of the role of the court in Iowa's history, and a lot of when the public, it's a public facility, and they do go to see it.
Yeah, they do go to see it. So that's
as you look back. And I know your mother and father are never too far from your thinking.
That's right.
I was present when you received the honorary Doctor of Laws degree from Drake University.
Yeah, and stop right there because I got to publicly thank you. That's the first time I saw that letter was yesterday. And I don't know how, you must have spent a ton of time coming up with all that information and writing such a wonderful letter to the committee that made the decision on the honorary degree.
Every word was true, but you spoke about your father, and sometimes you must look back to thinking about a 19-year-old kid in 1919 or 1920.
I couldn't do it.
The courage of your mom and dad, and then your own career. I think your dad would probably say, my kids are my legacy.
It's true.
I'm wondering, as you look back, that building is going to be everybody in the bar, I think everybody who's read the newspapers knows that building is part of your legacy, but what in addition to that, would you most like to be remembered for?
I try to be as fair and impartial as I could. I tried to call them as I saw them, and without any favor or fear. That's what I like to be remembered for. I try to be intellectually honest in my decisions. I didn't try to be result oriented, that kind of thing. That would be a good legacy.
That would be wonderful. That is a wonderful legacy. Let me pick up just for a moment on the word fairness, which you used in your State of the Judiciary address. The court's role is one of fairness and impartiality. You mentioned it several times here, and as we've talked about cases in which, however reluctantly, you speaking for the court came to the conclusion that certain legislation was unconstitutional. The 60-day notice, the differential tax, the nuisance immunity. Is a part of the role of the court in it discharging its responsibility of fairness, impartiality, and honesty, a sense to recognize that our Constitution, certainly our Iowa Constitution, is a living Constitution.
Absolutely. I always believe that it's a living Constitution. It's flexible, and it's got to change with the times, you know. And our interpretation has got to change with the times. It's a living document. It's not fixed. I don't believe in strict constructionalism, going back to 200 years, more than 200 years. I don't think so. I like to look at it as a living document.
I think nobody ever thought your opinions were anything but well-researched, honest. I speaking with Professor Bob Rigg, whom you know well, and he mentioned your opinion in the Jeffries case.
Yeah.
On lesser included offenses. He says, you know, the chief did a heck of a job, and that was a really live area for the criminal defense bar. He wrote a tremendous opinion. It's cited all the time. He didn't come out the way the defense bar wanted him to, but we still thought it was a good opinion.
Yeah. One other thing about that judicial branch building, as I travel from law office to law office, I see a picture of that building. Practically every office that I've attended. I think you probably have in your office, Mark. It's great. I think lawyers really, really are proud of that building. Yeah.
Well, and if we could think about law and its majesty, we would want law to be stand for independence, to be majestic, and yet to be accessible. And that building is a nice metaphor for each of those qualities. So, Mr. Chief Justice, thank you very much for this opportunity to speak with you, and look forward to our continuing friendship.
Thank you.
Okay.